All right, it's officially 1 o'clock Eastern time. Thank you everybody for joining. We're gonna go ahead and get started. So let's see, Teresa, are you able to read out those housekeeping notes? Because I can hand the mic over to you.
Yes.
Awesome.
So everybody, please mute yourself so that everybody can hear. We can hear things like typing and shuffling and stuff. So if everybody mutes themselves, then everybody can hear. You can ask a question by typing your questions into the chat area. And when I see that, I can read that aloud for everybody. And if we're not sure about something, we will ask you to unmute yourself so that you can ask a little bit more directly. Or if what we answered isn't what you were asking, then please clarify what your question was. We'll be recording this session, so it'll be available on demand. So if there's something you wanted the answer to, but you couldn't remember, or you want to share with other people in your organization, it'll be available on demand shortly. And that's it. It looks like we might be having some issues with sound. Amber, are you muted?
Yes, I was muted. Thank you, Teresa. So you were such a great team. So I'm going to go ahead and repeat myself. For the first 10 minutes, I'd love to just go over some updates, some things that I would want you guys to be aware of in terms of training opportunities, et cetera. And then for the rest of our time together, gonna kind of open this up as a Q&A, think of it as office hours so that we can answer any questions and troubleshoot with you guys directly. We'll probably be moving from the most broad kind of questions to the most specific questions so that you guys can drop off as you need to if the questions are getting a little bit too specific for you individually. So let's go ahead and get started. Hopefully everybody can see my background. It's a PowerPoint presentation. If you can't see that, go ahead and send a message directly to Teresa. I'm gonna go ahead and close down my chat window as well in case that's in the way for you guys. All right, so. We're all here about Maddie's Pet Assistant, right? And so we just recently launched new import possibilities with Shelter Buddy. So I saw in the questions that were submitted through the RSVP form that we had some questions about how to get started if your organization already has Shelter Buddy. And so we can kind of walk through what that may look like, but wanted to let you guys know that we are only directly importing from four animal management softwares right now. So that would be ShelterLove, PetPoint, Animal Shelter Manager, otherwise known as ASM, and Shelter Buddy. So if you are utilizing, say, rescue groups or Chameleon, unfortunately, we're not going to be able to automatically import your data from your system. We do offer the opportunity, if you wanted to manually enter that information into the back end, which is the MPA website. And we can always talk about that directly one-on-one if that is remotely appealing to you guys. I know that auto import is obviously kind of the desired way to go, but that's where we are right now in terms of integration. So we have a new MPA FAQ on our website. And so here is the link to that. And so I wanted to share with you guys that we do have this FAQ that is very new right now, and we're continuing to add information and questions and training materials to it on an ongoing basis. But right now it has some really basic information that you guys can check out if you're interested. And one of those pieces of information would be how to integrate with our various software platforms that we can automatically import from. So again, that's just at maddiesfund.org/MPA FAQ. And then you can always, if you just went to the MPA main page, you can always find the FAQ from there as well. And so here in the getting started and data section, we have all of these kind of integration how-tos, and specifically one for ShelterBuddy. So you can read this document for more detail. Most of the time with any of these integrations, we just need you to register, and then we'll ask for a specific URL or an authentication key or for you to publish information, however it is that you have been working with that particular piece of software. All right, and then I just wanted to call out that we've always had the ability for you guys to test the app yourself, but we do have a short form online now where we're asking you guys if you wanted to fill it out on your own. You could submit that to us, and then within 24 hours we can let you know how you get an automatic email just as if you were an end user, letting you know how to download the app and be able to log in and start testing. And so you can test the app as a pretend adopter or foster caregiver. And you can have a pretend kitten, adult cat, or adult dog. And I did see a couple of questions on the back end about puppies. And unfortunately, we don't have the capacity this fiscal year to actually build out the app for puppies under 8 weeks of age. All of our questions pertaining to foster dogs will be for foster dogs over 8 weeks of age, and that will follow our general kind of adult dog category. So again, if you have any questions about that, please reach out to us directly or send something in the chat to Teresa, and we can communicate one-on-one about that. Okay. Here's a new piece of training material. So this is again within the FAQ. If you just joined, if you wouldn't mind muting yourself, thank you, really appreciate it, and happy to have you. All right, so we have this new training checklist for foster care coordinators. And again, this is embedded within the FAQ. It's also available on the MPA group on the Maddie's Pet Forum. So if you're interested in joining that MPA group for administrators, we can definitely send you an invitation, or you can go onto the Maddie's Pet Forum and find that group and ask to join. And we have a bunch of training materials that are available there. So we're kind of trying to put things in two different places, right? One through the forum and another through the FAQ. But this checklist is kind of highlighting all of the resources that I think would be most important for foster care coordinators when they are first learning about Maddie's Pet Assistant. You can see what kind of topics it includes. So what to expect when you're importing, how-tos for the pet profile information, vaccination information, weight tracking, so that your foster care coordinators also know how to talk to your foster caregivers who may be interested in utilizing the app. Hi, thank you for joining. All right, so go ahead and check that out and let me know what you guys think, if the training checklist is helpful for you or not. And then also on the back end through the MPA website, I've also added this new tab that you guys may have noticed already. It's actually been live for the past few months, but that is the help tab. So if you hover over the help tab, you'll see two drop downs. One would be the FAQ. So if you clicked on that, then it would send you directly to the FAQ pages on the Maddie's Fund website. And then the second is Maddie's Pet Forum. So if you click on that, then it'll probably ask you to register if you haven't been in the forum before. And if you're not registered, I think it sends you to the main section of Maddie's Pet Forum, asks you to register. And then you can join our Maddie's Pet Assistant group. Again, that's just for administrators, not for end users. So not for the adopters, not for the foster caregivers. It's for us to be able to really talk on the back end, ask questions that may be common questions that all of us can learn from. And I also would love to utilize it as a place to gain feedback from you guys. All right. Let's see, click. Okay, I did mention this last time, but I wanted to mention it again for anybody that wasn't able to join at our previous Q&A, but there's a new button, a new function that's been added to the mobile app for end users, and that's the community button. Hey guys, thank you so much for joining. Make sure to mute yourself. Thank you. And so when you click on the community button, if you were an adopter or foster caregiver, it will send you to the Maddie's Pet Forum, which is available for the public use as well. So it'll work very similarly, I would say, as kind of a, well, not exactly similarly, but pretty similarly to like a pet MD or something like that, where they can look up articles around best practices for pets. They can also ask questions and get those questions answered by experts, by people in the field that we all work in, to make sure that they're getting the best information possible. So if they feel like the app isn't giving them the information that they need and they're not able to get in touch with you guys directly, instead of going just kind of generally on this Google search, then we can advise them to click on the community button and see if any of their questions can get answered there on the Maddie's Pet Forum. And we can talk about more of this later as well if you guys have questions. But just new functionality. All right, so this is a foster kitten who just got adopted from my house. And so I would love to get to your questions now before I talk too much and make everybody fall asleep. So let's go ahead and open this up. I'm gonna go ahead and click into the back end of the Maddie's Pet Assistant website, just in case they can direct us to any questions, solutions there. If you are joining as an audience member, go ahead and mute yourself. All right. So Teresa, go ahead and throw some questions at me.
Okay, and if anybody has questions, go ahead and type them into the chat bar, and I will also be reading questions that were submitted previously on the registration form. Can we give access to the surveys to our trainers?
Yeah, so I might need some clarification on that question, but the way that I'm interpreting it is, if there are survey responses, do you want to give access to the trainers to see those survey responses? Then I would suggest that you would add those folks as a user on the Maddie's Pet Assistant website, and you can do that by clicking here under the admin tab. You manage users, and then you can basically add a trainer as a user, but you can also not give them administrative functionality. So they can be just a general user, which means that they would see the pets tab, the people tab, the survey tab, the report tab, but they wouldn't be able to do any of these things, like manage the documentation or push notifications, organizational details, et cetera. So it's just adding a general user on the back end is something that you could be able, that you would be able to do. And then that way they would be able to look at any survey submissions that have been submitted. And this is all of our testing site right here. So don't be alarmed when you see all these red flags that are not reviewed. That's just from us testing within this particular organization called your organization's name. So hopefully that answered that question. Teresa, do you think that was clear enough?
I believe so. Okay. If that is not what you were asking, this came from the little red dog, let us know, and we can either clarify it here or send us an email.
Absolutely. And just to kind of piggyback on that, if you ever have any questions, you can ask us in the MPAA group on the forum, or you can send us an email directly at mpa@maddiesfund.org. And that is strictly, as it sounds, our MPA-based inbox for supporting you guys. All right, cool. Next question.
Actually, Amber, we got a little clarification on that from Little Red Dogs. Our question relates to an additional use. We follow our adopted dogs throughout their lifetime. Is there a way to create a survey that helps us track their quality of life periodically? And she also submitted this question for us to answer, but she's asking it now.
Okay. So with the surveys that go out from Maddie's pet assistant, they're on specific days throughout the first month of care. After that, we haven't been able to really put forward the content to check on, say, like an adopted dog a year down the line. That's something that we would love to do in the future, but it's definitely not in the goals for this particular fiscal year. So up to 30 days, we've really pretty much got you covered on being able to check in with adopters or foster caregivers. After that point, what I would suggest to you guys is if you wanted to schedule an email. And within that, you could basically automate this email to go out, say, 365 days or so after the adoption or foster care, well, hopefully not after the foster care date, but after the adoption date, and then have your own series of questions that you're asking them to respond to, and you can tell them where to respond to those answers as well. I know it's not a perfect solution by any stretch of the imagination, because one, if you send out an automatic email from the system, end users aren't able to directly respond to that email. They would have to click on a link to basically, or they would have to like click on an email address to then kind of start the conversation externally. Hopefully that makes some sense, but at least that way you can put out kind of a scheduled automated shout out, if you will, email to that person asking them to get back in touch with you from this system. Teresa, do you have anything that you would want to add there?
No, but to piggyback onto the personal emails to send out beyond what Maddie's pet assistant automatically does, there is a question about how to add organization specific information that can be pushed out to fosters and adopters. And I think there are a few ways that you may want to bring up that that could be done, something that's more personalized and not just from Maddie's pet assistant.
Yeah, absolutely. So this would really be your tab if you're looking to push out organizational information. So one would be this manage documents. And apologies, you guys are going to see other people's information here because I am a super user. But essentially, there is a section of the app that is called My Favorites. And in that section, there are defaulted documents that we have imported here from Maddie's Fund that we think are the like some really great documents to start off with. But every organization has the ability to add documents of their own that would automatically show up on the phone of the end user. And you can definitely send out a prompt or an email or a push notification letting that group of individuals know that a new document has been added. So it's really easy. You would basically just go ahead and add in your organization name. If you wanted to go out to adopters, foster caregivers, or both, the particular species that is being cared for, or both, and then put the document title. Document title will be visible. Document description will not be visible to the end user. Make sure that you click active so that it'll actually show up in the mobile app for those end users, and you just upload the file. So the file does need to be a Word document, a PDF, an Excel file, a PowerPoint, something like that. You can't upload a link at this particular moment in time, but I would suggest if you have like a list of links that you would love to share with your end users, just put them on a Word document and upload them here. Cancel. Let's go ahead and cancel. And then you could always, to let people know that it's there, if you want to prompt them, then you can send out a push notification. That would go to everybody's phone. Let's see. And then again, you can select if you want the push notification. And so just to clarify, a push notification is a message that pops up on someone's phone, even when they're not using the app. I mean, they have to have logged into the app at least once, given permission for those push notifications to go through. But then the same way as like Facebook or Instagram or whatever, like you see that someone's followed you or whatever that message may be, that's a push notification that'll show up as a banner at the top of your phone usually, just to make sure everybody knows what a push notification is. So you can send these and they go out immediately. There's no kind of like scheduling a future date for these or anything. They go out immediately to whomever you select, and you could let them know that a document has been uploaded, for instance. So cancel that. Or if you did want to schedule something, you could schedule an email to let them know about those documents for them to take a look, or you can just link to those documents from that email as well. So these are a couple of ways where you can start to reach out to your folks in ways that we as MPA, as Medi's Pet Assistant, aren't already reaching out to them. Okay, that was a long-winded response, but hopefully that made sense.
And I think you sort of touched on another question someone had about, can you send a text to multiple people at the same time? And I assume that they're speaking about that push notification.
Yeah, let me clarify. So you're not able to send text through Maddie's Pet Assistant. That would be amazing. I would love to do that in the future. Hopefully we could get the development approval to do so. But right now you can't send text through Maddie's Pet Assistant. You could send a push notification and you can send an email. And so you can... as I was stating, to reiterate, you can send an email to a specific individual or to your group of, say, cat fosters or dog adopters, those sorts of categories. But you wouldn't be able to, actually, I'm not sure. I'm like backing up now. It's like, do you get a list of all of your users? Let's see. Do schedule an email. If I pick specific person, oh, I can't pick specific person there. If I pick specific person, yeah, then you could send a push notification to several individuals at one time. Cool. I had to remind myself of that. Thank you for your question. All right, Teresa, what you got?
People seem to be excited about using the app, but when they get home, they don't use it.
Yeah, we see that sometimes, don't we? So I'm going to give you my spiel, which is that there's a much higher percentage of foster caregivers who utilize the app than percentage of adopters. And we all know why. Foster caregivers are more a part of our community. We have more touch points with them. They've opted in to be a part of our network, etc. So you are going to see a lower percentage of adopters utilizing Maddie's Pet Assistant. And we're generally running at about, I want to say, like 20% right now is what I'm looking at, like across the board for all organizations. It has gone up a little bit. But I want to remind you guys that this is just a tool in your toolkit when it comes to follow-up processes. We're definitely not going to capture every single one of your adopters, but hopefully we can get enough information so that you guys know what's going on out there from a research perspective of how your pets are doing, and to hopefully kind of check in on cases that would be more complex, etc. So that all being said, there is we do have, let's see, I'm going to go here to our main page. We do have a promotional toolkit, and we find that those that are highly promoting the app will have a higher adopter usage rate. So if you go here to our main MPA page on the Maddie's Fun website, related links over here, you can get to the promotional toolkit. And so just to clarify, these are specific tools to help you promote the app to foster caregivers or to adopters. One of my favorite things that we have here is this adorable little video that you can embed for foster caregivers. And so you can use this during orientations, you can put it in a newsletter, et cetera. I would love to create one for adopters as well. So it's definitely in the pipeline. But let's go ahead and scroll down here. So we have these postcards that you can print out, flyers that you can print out, a JPEG that you can insert in emails, et cetera. We have a cheat sheet for foster care coordinators that you can utilize when you're talking to a foster caregiver. And then the same here on the adoption side, a cheat sheet for adoption counselors so that you can just hopefully answer some quick questions about the app and know how to talk about the app in a pretty concise manner. And so again, I do find that when folks are utilizing these promotional tools that they do have a higher app usage rate from their adopters and foster caregivers. And if there's anything that you guys would love to see added to this toolkit, please let us know. We're very open to feedback. So we want to be able to help you guys reach out to your end users.
All right. And there is a question about, does Maddie's Pet Assistant receive adopters information from PetPoint? And then a kind of related question of data entered into PetPoint, does it go back into MPA, does it go back into PetPoint?
All right, so let me go back to the website just so you guys have something to look at. All right, so we will pull information, or we will receive information, actually, to be more specific and accurate, from your software systems. Again, if that is PetPoint, ShelterLove, ShelterBuddy, ASM. We do not, and that will all be housed here in the MPA website, just to clarify. We will not push information from the MPA website back into, say, PetPoint. So for instance, if an end user submits that, they have entered in a vaccination on their end for the adopted dog, Juno, that vaccination information that's been added by the end user would not go back into your animal management software. We want to keep your software data as pristine as possible. We definitely don't want it to be manipulated with information from the end user. Hopefully that makes sense, but trust me, it is all for the best. And then, so that was about, so it's definitely not a two-way street, it's a one-way street, where the software will shoot information to the website and the end user will shoot information to the website, to the MPA website, and it's just warehoused there and will stay there. Teresa, what was the first part of that question again?
Would Maddie's Pet Assistant receive the adopter's information from PetPoint? And probably wondering what kind of information is sent from PetPoint.
Okay, yeah, so actually what I was talking about before with the, the integration how-tos, there's a list of all of the information that is pulled over. And let me see, I'll go back here. So again, that's in the FAQ. You can see the how-tos for getting started and the data, how that syncs up. So if I just click on PetPoint here, then I get this document. And if we scroll to the bottom of this sheet, you can see what kind of information moves over. So a lot of it is just going to be part of your basic pet record information in your software, because we just primarily want to get kind of the pet name, the pet ID, and what relationship they have to an individual, and then that individual's information. So we want to know if they're adopted or in foster care, the date that that took place, so that we know when to start that kind of survey sequence, and then who to reach out to, right? So we really are taking as little information from your software system as we can in order to make the app function. And so additionally, it depends upon your software. So I would definitely check these how-to documents based upon the software that you're utilizing. We'll be pulling the vaccination information as well. Just to note, we don't pull information about weight from software into the MPA website. And that's just because it's very complicated and expensive to change those APIs that pull information from one software to another. So it's a nice to have. We hope to work on that in the future, but this is currently the information that we're able to pull.
Cool. And it imports twice a day.
Yes, that is true. So we are looking to get your latest and greatest information on an ongoing basis from your software. It is important to note that, again, every software integration is different. So with PetPoint, if any part of that original pet record in PetPoint changes, any part of it changes, we're going to receive an immediate update. With ShelterLove, currently, certain aspects of that pet record would have to change for us to get an update. And those would probably, those have to be kind of bigger pieces of information. So the pet status has changed, like the pet is deceased or returned, etc., or the health status has changed, or the adoption date has changed, or who the pet has been adopted by has changed. So if you're having individual questions about how your data is importing based upon your software, just please reach out to us so that we can clarify, because it is gonna be a little bit different depending upon what software you use. And apologies, I wish it were consistent across the board, but that's not the world that we live in, unfortunately.
All right, and we have a question about some adopters are confused about the content they're receiving and thought it was coming directly from the rescue organization. Is there any way to customize the replies to the adopters to reduce confusion and let them know if they need an urgent response to call them directly?
Yeah, so I think there's a lot to this particular question, but any of the emails that go to end users that are automated from the MPA website will have your organization in the signature. It'll say, you know, thank you sincerely, what have you. The salutation will say the name of someone at your organization as it's autofilled, and then will also say the name of your organization. So I guess I'm asking a clarifying question if the person is actually in the audience. Are you saying that you'd rather those automated emails come from something that says Maddie's Pet Assistant instead of from your organization? So that's one. Second part of that question is, unfortunately, you're not able to customize the emails that go out automatically from the Maddie's Pet Assistant website. So the ones that are not customizable would be reminding end users about a survey that's coming up, the introductory email, which tells end users how to download the app and has their login information. The vaccination reminder email is not customizable currently, but we do tell them, and actually let me pull this up so you guys can see the vaccination reminder email, just hopefully. And this screen is gonna look a little bit crazy. I'm letting you guys into the back end of the back end of the back end. So bear with me. All right, so this is what a vaccination reminder would look like for, let's do one for a foster caregiver because that's probably more concerning. So it's very general and says that it's not an appointment reminder. And tells them to contact you guys if they need to schedule an appointment for a foster appointment for a particular pet. And just says, this is the date that's in our system. If it's not correct, reach out to you guys. If it's not correct, they can update the vaccination section on their own so that they know that they're getting accurate information. And actually, this does come from Maddie's pet assistant, since we know that it's, you know, it, since we tell them to reach out to you guys separately and individually. Okay. But again, if you did want to send out an additional email that is from you guys directly, I would do it here in the under the admin section. Teresa, is there anything that you would suggest, anything that I'm not thinking of?
I suppose when you are letting the doctors or caregivers know about the app, let them know it's an app that your organization is using, but not necessarily your exact answers. I mean, you could let them know.
Yeah.
There was a question about...
I'll piggyback on that. So when someone fills out a survey, there's a particular response that they've selected, like the kitty has diarrhea, then they will automatically get advice pertaining to that particular condition, situation, what have you. And within that automated response, depending upon the severity, we will definitely tell them to reach out to you guys directly. And so we just think of it as a filter. We want to be your first line of response here, so that the survey goes out, people are thinking about what is going on with their pet, needing to monitor their pet, getting a little bit more information about their pet in ways that maybe they hadn't thought of before that a survey is prompting for them. Depending upon their answers, they're going to get automated responses. And within those automated responses, again, depending upon the complexity, we're going to try to give them some baseline information, a few links for where to seek out additional information if it's not an emergency situation, and then saying that they should contact you guys if the condition gets worse over time, or if it's not getting better, they should contact you guys. If it's an emergency situation, they should reach out to you guys immediately, and we have your emergency contact information like auto-coded, hard-coded within that piece of advice. And sorry to kind of just keep on rambling here, but if you go online to the FAQ, then you can see examples. Oops, that's not the right one. You can see examples of what these surveys look like and the responses that folks would get for kittens, cats, and dogs. So you can see exactly what we would be telling them based upon what they've submitted. And again, you can check this out on the FAQ. Thanks. We're excited about the new FAQ. All right, Teresa, what's next?
And if you guys wanted to share your emergency protocol or contact information, that's something you might be able to upload to your My Favorites or schedule as an automatic email to go out a few days after foster or whatever. All the information there. That's another way of providing that for your caregivers.
Yeah, that's really, I'm glad that you brought that up, Teresa, because that is really, really important. And that's kind of like my number one suggestion is the kind of general foster care packet or adoption packet that you hand out to someone in print form. It's already in print form. Just go ahead and upload that to My Favorite, so you know that people that are using the app, they don't have to go looking for some piece of paper somewhere. They can have your contact information or the information that you guys have deemed to be the most important. They'll have that on their phone everywhere that they go, and let them know that it will be there.
And there was a question about the possibility of extending surveys beyond the first month. Is that something that Maddie's pet assistant would be interested in doing in the future?
We definitely would love to extend surveys past the first month. We've definitely talked about a 90-day and then a 1 year, for instance. Right now, we are not doing any development on the app. We're basically implementing it in as many organizations as we can as it stands, so that we can give people kind of that first step in managing the first 30 days. And if Maddie's Fund continues to develop this app in the future, that is very high on my list of things to add, including surveys for puppies. But right now, in this particular fiscal year, I don't think it's going to be an addition. Definitely something that we would want to do in the far future. So apologies, I'm on your side, I'm in your boat. We both want to see it happen. Unfortunately, it can't happen too soon for us. But that's where I would suggest, if you wanted to send out your own scheduled emails through the website, you could do so.
These are all the questions that I have in the chat bar so far. Does anybody have anything they'd like to add? And if the chat's not working for you, you might be able to just unmute your microphone and ask. Does Maddie's Pet Assistant give suggestions for behavioral issues as well as health issues?
Yes, absolutely. Let's go ahead and take a look at some of those survey questions. Let's go to dogs. That seems appropriate. So this is an example survey and set of questions and automatic advice for a foster caregiver of dogs over 8 weeks of age. And so the first set of questions are going to be around health, and then the latter set of questions within the surveys are going to be about behavior. And so you can see the surveys aren't actually this long. We're just giving you a wealth of information here. But you can see we have some questions here about how scared the dog appears to be toward you and toward different targets. So we have questions about fearfulness, and we also have questions about what we call grouchiness, because we don't want to necessarily code this as aggression. We try to remove any kind of alarming terminology around behavior on the back end of this. And so we'll say something like, has Goose seemed grouchy or irritable toward any of the following folks? And then they would check off kind of where this grouchiness, this irritability has been targeted, and then provide some suggestions, some helpful tips and additional information about that. And actually, I think it's important to state that the person who wrote and reviewed all of these automated responses, she is Dr. Sheila Darpino. She is a veterinarian specialized in shelter medicine and also in behavior. So she's a really great representative of great gold standard behavior information. So hopefully you'll find our behavior sections particularly helpful. All right, do we have any other questions out there? Type them in or holler them out. Feel free to unmute yourself. We're getting loose here. All right, Teresa, did you have any questions?
There is now an additional question. Where would one access a copy of the survey sent out for dogs? Do you mean the standard questions that are sent out or the surveys that are returned from a caregiver?
I'll go ahead and answer both. So when an end user submits a survey, then the person who is deemed as the survey reviewer for that particular pet, the survey reviewer will receive an email letting them know what the survey responses were and the automated responses that were populated based upon what that caregiver had to say. So you get an email, and then also all of that data for everyone is on the back end here. You can see an inventory of all survey submissions here on the survey tab. You can click on this orange button over here to filter through. So say you only want to see survey submissions that have a blue color code or a yellow color code or a red color code, which is an emergency situation. You can do that here. You can look at just survey submissions from foster caregivers or from a specific date and time. Let's see. Or you can look at ones that are just assigned to you. So you are the survey reviewer on this particular pet. Let's see. See if I even have any. So no, I don't have any right now. So go ahead and close that out. So that's one way that you can review all the surveys. Close. Also, if you go to the pets tab, you can see if surveys have been submitted for a particular pet. Let's see. Let's see if there are any here. So if you click on the gear icon, then you'll see other options appear here. And so if you hover over this, it'll say pet surveys. You click on the pet surveys icon. My internet is not happy today, so I apologize. But you can see any surveys that have been submitted. And if there are more than one survey that had been submitted here, I'll show you a drop-down list and you can choose which one you wanna look at. But you can see that Dr. Darpino submitted this introductory survey for this particular kitten. And these were the responses. Here are the pieces of advice that were given. So that's how to kind of check it once it's submitted. The other part that could have been about this question was, how can you guys see kind of a document of the questions and pieces of advice that are available? Then I would suggest, again, going to this FAQ, and we can send this directly to you guys too if you send us an email. But go to this FAQ under surveys and advice. You can see what kinds of questions and responses are out there for these different groups. And I will say that the foster care surveys are very similar to the adoption surveys, with of course some nuance in how we tell them to reach back out to you guys. For adopters, we would tell them to reach out to their veterinarian for more instruction or advice. For foster caregivers, we would tell them to reach out to the foster care coordinator or the contact information that you guys have given us. So a little bit of nuance there, but most of the content within those surveys and within the advice is going to be pretty similar. So you can look at these as examples of a lot of what's out there. The algorithm on the back end for surveys is quite extensive and quite large, but this is a really good summation of what you're going to be seeing.
There is an organization that uses Chameleon, which is not currently integrated with Maddie's Pet Assistant, and they are interested in knowing how to make Maddie's Pet Assistant work for them the easiest way.
Yeah, unfortunately, if your software doesn't automatically integrate for automatic import, then there's not a really easy way. But we do give the option, let me actually move that bar. We do give the option of manually adding pets into the back end. And so if you wanted to, as an organization that doesn't have a software that integrates, or maybe doesn't have management software at all, then you could maybe select a group, a category of pets that you wanted to focus on for the app, if you wanted to test it, or if you were interested or curious. So for instance, you could start with, well, we want to try Maddie's Pet Assistant with foster kittens under 8 weeks of age. Then maybe you can start with like a subsection or with just like beta, just a few pets, and see if it's worth the extra effort that I would take to enter in information for that pet. And so I'm gonna go ahead and press save on this record so that I can show you guys what information cannot be left blank. So these are the required fields. So if you were manually entering a pet, the least that you can do are these required fields, right? So we would need to know the pet ID, pet name, species, sex, date of birth, and this can be estimated, obviously. And then we would want to know what the relationship type is. And because without having that tie in to an individual or through a relationship, then the system doesn't work to follow up with anybody, right? Because there's nobody to follow up with. So you would have to add in the adopter or foster caregiver information. And what's required here is, I have to move this bar again. Let's see, register. So you can see here that you would need to have a first name, a last name, and an email address. And so having that email address triggers basically all of the actions within Maddie's Pet Assistant. When we have a person's email address that is directly linked to a pet, that's our first trigger that we send out that automatic kind of canned introductory email that has information. Well, it basically says, your organization would like for you to use Maddie's Pet Assistant. This is a little bit about it. This is how you download it. Here's your login information. If you have any questions, contact your organization. So that's all being driven by this person's email address in this particular field. Okay, let me close out of that. So I know manual entry is not the sexiest option by any stretch of the imagination, but if it is something that you're curious about, I would say register as a manual organization. You'll have a little checkbox that says you're going to manually enter in your information, and then enter in a few pets as a beta, pilot it, see how you feel about it. All right, Teresa, we got anything else?
Not currently. Does anybody else have anything they want to clarify or add or mention? We got some love on the chat bar from Top Dog Foundation.
Thank you. We like some love. Makes us feel good. And we actually have like 8 minutes until this little session, this Q&A, our office hours are officially closed for the day. So if you have anything else you'd love to ask, go ahead and shoot it out now. Otherwise, I'm just going to stay on the line in case anyone has anything last minute. If nobody has anything that they would like to ask, then feel free to jump off now. We really appreciate your time. And be sure to, if something does come up, to join the MPA group of the Maddie's Pet Forum, where you can always ask questions. You can also directly reach out to us at mpa@maddiesfund.org. And Teresa is going to be really on top of that inbox and answering your questions. She does a great job. So again, that's mpa@maddiesfund.org for our direct email.
And I put that in the chat bar for people, along with a couple other links that you mentioned, the toolkit, the forum. So you guys can check out the chat bar. And if you missed anything or the chat bar is not working, send us an email or a forum note or something.
Thanks, Teresa. So who else do we still have with us? Laura, Addie, Erin, do you guys have any questions? We are all yours. Hey, Addie.
No, thank you for helping. We're pretty small, Golden Gate Basset Rescue. We joined Maddie's Pet Assistant and we tested it between ourselves. But our biggest barriers, if you like, are the fact that you don't link with our shelter software, which is, we use rescue groups.
Rescue groups, yeah.
And so therefore it needs us as individuals to push it to our fosters and adopters. And we don't do it in person. A lot of it's done by email. So. Yeah. it's just a little bit of a barrier. And then I was the one who asked the question, or I was one of the people who asked the question about like tailoring our info. One way we thought it would work with foster homes is to give them a lot more of our protocols, the way we want to do things. Mm-hmm. Now you've helped today, because now I know a little bit more about where to go to put that information in. But we also have, you know, very few foster homes who are tech savvy, who would use an app on a phone.
Yeah.
So, you know, we want to use it, but it will probably be very slow in take up.
Sure. I completely understand that too. I mean, it does, the app does function on iPhones and on Androids, but we know that not everybody has those types of phones, and not everybody who has that phone necessarily wants to add an app. But I would, you know, continue to promote the app as totally free. It doesn't actually take up that much space on their phone. So it's not like adding Facebook or something like that.
Exactly. It's not that active. If they want to use it, I think the info you've got in there is really good. Everything I've read so far is like, oh, that's good. That's good.
Right. And just as an FYI, I don't know if this could happen in the future, but we've definitely thought about other things. Like, I would love to, personally, I would love to make this app available on desktop. I would also love to make this app available to individuals so that they can register themselves. So they can, you know, people can literally opt in to it, regardless of if their organization wants to or not. These are things that we are discussing. Yes. So I don't know if they're going to be moving forward that way, but they're definitely all up here. Yeah. And
big things start small.
Yeah, exactly. And to the point of you guys having to use this, having to do manual entry, I say, you know, so we have those sheets out that tell you what the questions are and what the answers are. If you want to poach any of that information, please feel free to do so. We want you guys to be able to utilize the best you can all the information that we've put together, and for, you know, your end users to get gold star information. So if you need to ever reach out to me to ask, you know, what's the messaging around this or around that, then please, you know, don't hesitate to reach out.
No, thank you. I think it's a good resource. And if one or two people take it up, that's a good thing. It's just a shame that we aren't in a position to, you know, wholeheartedly adopt it and say every single adopter and foster will now be using it. So
yeah, and I want to continue our conversations with rescue groups. Just unfortunately, that particular piece of software has its own barriers in how we can actually get the information out. So we're continuing those conversations.
Good, it's good to know. Yeah. But it's interesting to know that it doesn't feed both ways. I mean, the most obvious advantage would be if it did feed both ways, so that the foster homes put in an update on a vaccine and it does go back to the record. The fact that it doesn't, that's fine. If we were a shelter with hundreds of adopters walking through the door trying to use this, then the automatic input from our shelter software would be more valuable, because we're going to manually input. Not the end of the world for us. So,
okay.
You know. So thank you for being there.
Yeah, of course. Thank you, Addie, for joining. Did anyone else have any questions? I see we have Laura and Erin on the line. Great. Okay. Well, I actually think we're at time, so we'll go ahead and just shut down for the day. And again, thank you everybody for joining. Please don't hesitate to reach out if you have any questions. We are looking forward to helping you guys out and learning more and hearing what you all have to say.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a good one. Bye-bye. Bye.